with an organization called Sambhav. It's located in Odisha in Niagara district. But you know, we have expanded our horizon much wider, reaching to people in different districts, in different states, and also beyond the country. So we started our experiment way back in 1989. We got registered on 8th March 1989. And we started the experiment on a completely barren land, abandoned land. People almost lost hope that nothing could grow there. So in one of the meetings in 1988, when we were sharing with the local people what exactly we want to do, so at the end of the meeting, one elderly person stood up and he said that, you are all from cities and whatever you are saying sounds good to the ear, because it's impossible, you cannot grow anything on this piece of barren land. So that's how we accepted the challenge, and then we said that, okay, we'll make this possible. The name emerged from that Sambhav, because he said it's a Sambhav, you can't grow anything here. And now we have more than 1,000 species there, species of plants, and in one species also we have many varieties, like for example, rice, we have 470 varieties, mango 68 varieties, citrus 12 varieties, like that, you know, for everything we have a lot of diversity. So both inter-species diversity and intra-species diversity. So our focus has remained from the beginning on environment and gender issues. On the environmental issues, we are focusing on conservation of natural forest, practice, experiment, promotion of organic farming technologies, biodiversity, and village sanitation, health and sanitation, and overall resource conservation activities. And on the gender issues, we are focusing upon organizing women around their issues. And once they are organized well, we provide them with support, not financial, it's only information and technical support, like how to enhance their income little bit, their skill little bit, so that they can be more resilient. Then we provide also support to women in distress, both women and children in distress and crisis. So these are the major thrust areas of the organization. And since 89, on a piece of barren land, 90 acres of barren land, we have been working continuously, and it's all on organic principles from day one. We never used any herbicides and any agrochemicals in that plot. And now we are able to produce seeds there, open pollinated seeds, which we exchange with farmers only, not with companies or research organizations. That's not our agenda. So we have participated in many such events and shared our knowledge about it. And we will be happy if people go organic and grow organic. If someone is working with the issue of agriculture, it starts with seed and soil. So how can we do agriculture without having seed? So I think the question itself, what seed means to me, means everything for agriculture, everything for agriculture. Without that, we can't. It's a cultural heritage as well. See, it's, you know, sometimes we just associate culture and agriculture so much, so intensively, we tend to forget that they are two different things. But it's essentially a cultural heritage, and it has become the lifeline of farmers since thousands of years. Yeah. So we just can't isolate these two. It's part of life, part of life. Different kinds of challenges we are facing as farmers. At farm level, the major challenge is like we are facing a lot of natural challenges, climate related challenges, like cyclone, drought, water, like that. Then wildlife, a lot of wildlife are there already coming to the farm, so they are making their life quite difficult. So it has become very difficult to save thousands of varieties from them. And the other challenges are from like economic challenges and then connecting to the larger world. And people ask that, are you certified? How do you know that it's organic? I think that, you know, it's a question, the question should be other way around. Like you should, the company should claim that this is hybrid, we have used chemicals, like that. It's not like you ask us whether it's organic and certified or not. And it has always become a challenge that the major challenge which I feel, many research organizations owned by government and also companies, they always accessed very easily farmer seeds. But if I go as a farmer to any of the research organizations, it's so difficult for me to get a single seed from them. They say that it's national property, it's meant for research, and how easily they can take it away from the farmers. And that's the major challenge I think farmers are facing. And you know, by bringing all these strange laws related to seed, used to be common property, our heritage, common heritage, common knowledge was associated with that. And one fine day farmers find that, yeah, this has to be registered. So in somebody's name, in some place's name, what is this? They don't understand all these things. And the lawmakers never ask them whether you need this kind of law or not. And when you go and tell to the people, they say, is there some law like this? That we can't sell our seeds, you know. So it's very, very strange for them. So that has become a very big challenge. Because farmers were never involved, real farmers. And most of our farmers can't read and write. And they can't even think about all these conspiracies that is happening at different levels, state, national, international levels. So the scientific community was never, I can tell you with confidence, you know, was grateful to the farmers who have been preserving all these seeds over the ages. And for them only, they are able to develop different varieties. And interestingly, they are not into, good also, they are not into sell business of these indigenous varieties. Probably that is why we are able to save all these varieties. And farmers are still having all these varieties, and it's always the government extension system and the companies who tell that indigenous seeds, they are low yielding, just get rid of them. We are offering you high yielding varieties, we are offering you package of practices, you follow this so that your yield will go up. So with seeds, the whole lot of other alloys like chemical fertilizers, pesticides, then water, energy, machineries, all these things come in. So people are almost in the net, you know, they don't understand that they're all, it's like a spider's web, I can tell. They don't understand that what exactly happening around them. Because for 70 years they have been told that it's useless. So it's very, very difficult to raise interest again, particularly for the farmers who have left indigenous varieties long back. But there are still some farmers who are growing this and they want to grow this for their own reasons. And the government system is not prepared to buy either indigenous varieties or even the producers from indigenous varieties. There's a big challenge small and marginal farmers are facing who have little surplus to sell also. Whereas they possess much more nutritional value, but it's not available. And through the modern agriculture, the whole food is denutrified. And I can say poor urban consumers, they're suffering from malnutrition, I can say, because they're not eating not getting nutritive food. It's not only the children or women in the tribal areas, remote areas, they are suffering from malnutrition. Even urban consumers don't get good food to eat. So it's an issue of both urban people and rural people. And they should learn. And so sad that many urban people, they have lost their knowledge, but they know how to use many different varieties of food crops. The genetic basket has narrowed down, the food basket has narrowed down, also the knowledge basket has narrowed down. And so you become more and more vulnerable by using the monocropping and also one kind of seed. So we should understand all these things.